Hello, fellow law nerds. Welcome to a special episode of Boom Lawyered, a Rewire Newsgroup podcast hosted by the legal journalism team. That is me. I'm Rewire Newsgroup senior editor of law and policy, Imani Gandy. And today, I'm super excited because I am joined by the one, the only, Elie Mystal. He is the nation's justice correspondent. He covers the courts, the criminal justice system, and politics. He is an Alfred Nobler Fellow at the Type Media Center. And if you haven't read his book, the best-selling Allow Me to Retort, A Black Guy's Guide to the Constitution, I don't know what's wrong with you. I have it in audio, hardback, and paperback. So you can call me an Elie Mystal stan if you must. I will take on that moniker. Elie, thank you so much for joining us today, or joining me.
It's so nice to be on with you. This is the last official work event I have before some downtime and vacation. So
downtime and vacation that you are most deserving of. My work wife, Jessica Mason Piclo, is actually on some downtime and vacation herself. She packed up the fam and drove across the country to escape the shenanigans. So thank you for deciding to step in and join me in today's shenanigans. And honestly, my first question for you is just going to be, what the hell, man? Like, just, I have watched you for months before the Dobbs decision come down, really speaking out in favor of abortion rights, in favor of the rights of pregnant people and women to control their own bodily autonomy. I even sat and watched as your language changed from pregnant women and you started to use pregnant people. I was personally very proud because I love to see that sort of inclusiveness and people learning. And quite frankly, I think you are maybe the only journalist besides me and Jess who are really just pounding, and legal journalists that are really just pounding the table day in and day out, taking a lot of shit from people on Twitter, because from my estimation, you expect this administration to do better than it has been, and they're not doing as well as they could be. And I don't think that you're coming from a position of, oh, let's burn everything down, screw it. You know, Phoenix is going to rise from the ashes. I think you want Democrats to succeed. So can you explain to me why it is people are crawling up your ass all the time when all you want is for democracy to succeed and for Democrats to succeed?
Well, Imani, you know, thank you so much for the introduction. I have a couple of different theories about this, and none of them are positive, right?
Okay.
None of them speak well for us as a people, right? So kind of theory number one that I've kind of all that I've had for a while and always have been operating on is that there are people in this movement, in this country and in this movement, who understand what abortion is, understand how the female reproductive system works, people who can find or know what is the clitoris, you know, those people, right?
Yeah.
And we're a minority.
Like, yeah.
And we are in a numerical minority, right? And so, like, part of the difficulty in the abortion debate is that people literally don't understand what it is. And then when you go to the legal part of the abortion debate, they have no idea what Roe v. Wade was. They have no idea what Planned Parenthood v. Casey stood for. You know, I first started really, you know, digging in on reporting and analyzing abortion issues during the kind of proliferation of trap laws that we saw in the teens, right? Because that was, let's say, my real first, like, man, they're trying to stop this thing, right? They ain't playing, right? Like, this is, you know, trap laws themselves were already whittling down at the access to abortion. If you don't have access to abortion, you functionally don't have that right already, right? So there's one group of people who just, like, has never understood that and has never been engaged, right?
Yeah.
So that's kind of theory A. Theory B, in terms of, like, why people are crawling up our ass and why there seems to be such a lack of oomph about this, is that people themselves are uncomfortable with abortion. We literally live in a country right now where we have an allegedly pro-choice president who's afraid to say the word abortion.
Yeah.
Right? He's like Kay from Godfather 2. It was an abortion, Michael. It was unholy. Like, I expect him to say that every time, right?
Yeah.
Like, he acts like it's this horribly shameful thing that we should all be like very, very sad about. And I think that unfortunately, he speaks for a lot of people, so that when the administration seems to not do anything, seems to drag its feet, seems to not be willing to go to the mattresses to defend this right, it then justifies a lot of other people doing the same thing, not taking to the streets, not marching, not protesting, not buttonholing their local candidates, doing whatever it is they don't do to support abortion. Because if the president's not going to do anything, then why should they have to do anything? And actually, everything's going to be fine. And like, you know, the few, and that's the other like dirty dark secret about the abortion debate in this country. Most people think that it's that the really deserving people, the people who deserve to have bodily autonomy, they'll find a way. There'll be an escape hatch. There'll be an option for them. It's just the sluts. It's just the sluts who think, who use abortion like birth control, who are going to be put out by this decision and world. And if that's how you think of it, then you also think that it's okay to like sit on your couch at home and not do anything and not demand anything better.
I mean, I find I agree with you. When you what you first said about people not knowing what Roe is or what it says, they don't. Jessica and I did an entire podcast where we listened to the oral arguments and we kind of broke them down in a very Mystery Science Theater 3000 kind of way. Just, I mean, and did you know that the attorneys for Texas actually raised the promiscuous sluts argument in court? Like, yeah, they said that part of their, of course, you know, our listeners should know that that was one of the arguments that Texas made, is that they had an interest in making sure that there weren't too many promiscuous sluts in Texas. So, I mean, I think that that speaks to the level of discomfort that people have about abortion. But also, it's like, the internet is a vast, wide source of material. Just Google Roe and see what it says. It doesn't just say you can have abortions now. Just like Dobbs didn't say, okay, we're criminalizing abortion. And that's one thing that I think when you talk about people being uncomfortable with this world that we're living in, I think that not only are people on the left uncomfortable, but I think conservatives are starting to panic a little bit based on the narratives that they have sort of clung onto in the wake of Dobbs, right? One thing you hear them say all the time is Dobbs didn't criminalize abortion, so just calm down, right? All Dobbs did was return political power to the people, right? To the states, so that the people duly elected or their representatives duly elected by the people can then go and make, you know, the states, the people of the states' voice on abortion heard. Well, that's crap, obviously, because the people who are going to vote in favor of bodily autonomy have been systematically disenfranchised over the last decade and even before. So, I mean, I think we could argue that it started with Bush v. Gore, but, you know, certainly since 2013 with Shelby v. Holder. So this idea that we are returning to democratic principles and that Dobbs didn't criminalize abortion, it's just a reset, is enraging to me, first of all. Second of all, I think that the people who marched for this shit, you know, the Students for Life and the people at protesting abortion on campus, I don't think they really understood what they were marching for. I think that they thought that they were marching for what you said, right? Making sure promiscuous sluts weren't using abortion as birth control. They didn't think that if, you know, when they, you know, the people who were, say, 17, 18, 19 marching a decade ago, they're now 28, 29, 30. Maybe they have an ectopic pregnancy that they expect to be treated. And they're in a hospital right now bleeding out because there are doctors who, yeah, Dobbs didn't criminalize abortion, but Alito and the court knew that by sending it back to the states, there are about half the states in this country that are going to have it criminalized by this time next year. So I don't buy that Dobbs didn't criminalize abortion. And I think that conservatives are nervous because it's starting to come out that, no, they really meant all abortions. They really meant treatments for ectopic pregnancy. They really meant no exception for rape or incest or for the health of the pregnant person. I mean, in Idaho, the Republican Party adopted a total abortion ban as their platform, and an amendment to make it available for ectopic pregnancy didn't just fail, it failed by a lot. Yep. A lot. So I think that you're right. And what I would love to happen is to see people who maybe just thought abortion was just a bad thing for bad people to sort of wake up and realize what they need when they have a miscarriage, an incomplete miscarriage, is an abortion. What they need when they have an ectopic pregnancy to terminate a pregnancy, that's an abortion. So I just find it so frustrating that nobody thought about this beforehand, and that we are yet again letting conservatives gaslight and manipulate the public by pushing a narrative that Dobbs didn't do what it did, and then hoping that people don't get pissed off about it.
Well, it goes back to this country's deep-seated hatred for women. Mm. You know, my wife is from Zimbabwe, right? Mm. And one of the things that she's always said about this country that I was not, like, keyed on to, you know, when we met in college or whatever. That was not my lived experience. But she was always keyed on to, like, coming to this country as a new person, as a new immigrant, that, you know, this country hates women. Mm-hmm. You know, like, you give my wife, like, would you, is it worse to be black or woman? And she's always like, well, first of all, it's worse to be both. But,
right, I would agree.
but if you had to choose, like, you know, the sexism of this country is much more kind of raw and unvarnished and much more diffuse, if you will, than the racism, right? And part of that is that, you know, to go back to what we're talking about, it's not just that people didn't understand the legal reality of Roe v. Wade. I mean, it's that people really, at a core level, did not pass sex ed in mm-hmm. eighth or ninth grade and just don't understand how it works. Like, I'll personalize it, right? So I am a relatively educated man, right?
Relatively, okay. Relatively educated, right.
I have read books and stuff, right? But learning about pregnancy through my wife getting pregnant with our first child was just like that mm-hmm. Weebe clip gift, right?
Right.
Like, wow, that's you know, just the, you know, you saw this during SB8 when people said, you know, oh, it's you don't know that you're, how do you not know that you're pregnant after 6 weeks? I'm like, yo, by the time they tell you you're pregnant, it's already technically four, mm-hmm. right? Because they count it from your last period. You don't go in until you've missed a period. You've already lost 4 weeks by the time you pee on the stick, right? Like, people don't understand that. People don't understand how the reproductive system actually works. And so then when they come over the top with their ignorance, right? Their ignorance on how the female body actually works, and then they come off over the top and try to regulate it, you get what you're talking about. You get people who say they're marching for life, who say they're marching for one thing and literally have no idea what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. But the conservatives on the Supreme Court did. They've always known what they're talking about. They've always known what they're trying to take away. And to your point about returning it to the states, you know, I've said before, this had to happen in sequence. They had to take away voting rights mm-hmm. first before they could take away abortion rights. That's not an accident. That's not a coincidence of history. They had a plan to do this, and vote and cutting voting rights was always the first part of the plan to do everything that they wanted to do. Right. That's why, and I've said this before, the thing that unites a Trump judge and a W judge and an HW judge and a Reagan judge is antipathy towards voting rights. Mm-hmm. It's not abortion. It's not corporate tax cuts.
That the was one thing Paul that
Roberts, and, I know you know this, but a lot of your listeners don't. Like, Roberts' first job after clerking was working against the Voting Rights Act. He was brought in to the Reagan administration specifically to argue against the 1982 Lonnie Guinier amendments to the Voting Rights Act. He lost that battle to Reagan because back in 1982, even Republican St. Ronald Reagan had to be like, it would be racist to not let people vote. Like, that's how far we've gone, right?
Yeah.
But Roberts eventually got his way, because when you look at Brnovich v. Arizona, when you look at the 2021 case that gutted Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act, all Roberts really did was go back and look at those 1982 amendments to the Voting Rights Act that really, and just so people know, those amendments are what allowed us to sue for laws that had a disparate impact on voting, as opposed to, like, so you don't have to have the legislature, I just don't like them darkies voting. So we're, like, they don't have to say it. Right. As long as they do it, you can see them. And so Roberts took that away in 2021, which was what he was hired to do
in like 1980, whatever. Yeah. I want to get back to what you were saying about how people don't understand science. They don't understand how the anatomy works, how the reproductive system works. Can you talk about why it is or how it is that we could get courts to pay more attention to, for example, the Daubert standard, which is the standard for expert witnesses, right? How can we re-inject science and fact into litigation, into these constitutional cases? Because it cannot be that an Ohio legislator thinks that an ectopic pregnancy can be re-implanted into the uterus, and therefore, and this has that particular, that happened, that the Ohio legislator, but what I'm about to say didn't happen. So let's assume that Ohio legislator, you know, writes legislation and actually incorporates the bad science about, yes, you can absolutely re-implant ectopic pregnancies into the uterus as part of the preamble to the bill, right? So then it goes to litigation, and courts will look at it and they'll be like, well, we can't really question the science because that's not our job. Our job is to look at the law. Legislators, they can put in whatever they want. We look at the law. And so then what you have is these pieces of legislation that wind their way through the courts just chock full of junk science. All of the shit about fetal pain and how fetuses can feel pain and fetuses are masturbating in utero. I mean, that was a thing that someone actually said about a decade ago. We can't let people have abortions because babies in utero have the right to jerk off. I mean, that was literally one of the reasons. It's absurd. And so when you go back and think about all of those things, why is it courts can't say, no, actually, Plan B is not an abortifacient. No, actually, birth control pills aren't abortion-inducing drugs. No, actually, fetuses can't feel pain. No, actually, you can't reimplant a pregnancy into the uterus. Why aren't we doing that? And what is the way that you see that we could get to that point?
All right, well, there are two things. One, it all starts with education. It all starts really with, it's almost like everything always goes back to high school, right? Like, we're all still on the bus in high school saying, I don't want you to sit next to me. that's all when it goes back to, right? But like, people graduate high school with a functional understanding of how to jerk off, right?
Right.
People graduate high school with a fundamental understanding of like what the penis is used for and how that plays into the reproductive process. People understand that. It's not because the penis is particularly simple. I mean, it kind of is, but you know, there are things going on, there are tubes and urethra, right? People get it.
Right.
We don't teach people about women's anatomy. We just don't. We're scared of it. We act like, because women are so sexualized and so treated as just vessels for male enjoyment, we just don't teach even women, to say nothing of men, how they actually work.
Yeah.
How their bodies actually work. And so when you don't teach people in school what happens, and when the entire subject is treated as some kind of massively taboo thing, when you have, you know, media and whatever that treats sex as the thing that gets X-rated, but like John Wick murdering half of New York City with a pencil, that's just fine. Like, right. When you have this entire culture that's around the exoticization and mystery of the female body, you get really fucking dumb people about the female body, right? So that's like a societal problem that we need a societal solution for. I always like to think that, you know, I bet the French just naturally understand this better because they don't have coat hangers up their butts about it, right? Like, they understand this and soup like way better than
soup.
Like your average American, right? So that's like, that's big picture number one. Small picture number two, we just have to have a better process for appointing judges. We have to have better judges. We have to elect better judges, although I'm not a huge fan of judicial elections for different reasons.
Well, because of the Judicial Crisis Network and all the money they pour into local elections. I mean, Jesus Christ.
And there's also, like, what is a judge running on? I'm super fair. Like, how is that? Like, right. What is that, right? What it turns out is that they run on, I put criminals in jail.
I put more black kids in jail than white kids, yeah.
So I'm not a huge fan of judicial elections, but we need a better process for identifying, picking, appointing, and confirming judges at all levels of our system, federal, state, and local, right? Because judges are supposed to be people who, I don't want to say above it all, because I don't like to, idolize anybody or any profession, but they are supposed to be able to execute judgment. Mm-hmm. Right. That is literally in their job description. Right. So I don't need the judge to be themselves the expert. I need the judge to be able to discern expertise. Mm-hmm. And right now we don't screen for that at all. We don't. We can talk about how conservatives pick their judges and what they pick their judges for. But just staying on the liberals for a second, there has not been a president in my lifetime that could give me a good, tight, one paragraph answer for what they're looking for in a judge. Mm-hmm. The last presidential election, when we had, eight different people running, we had the coffin man running, we had Mayor Stop and Frisk running, what kind of judge? They all thought, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. What kind of Ruth Bader? You know she's done. She's not here
anymore.
Like Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Like, right? That's all they said.
Yeah,
I'm writing as an aside, I'm writing a feature piece right now on for print on Sonia Sotomayor.
Oh, good.
Just to be like, exciting. Hey, there's another one.
Thank you. You know, that's so
doing
funny.
Doing the things.
Jess and I did a, like, Sonia Sotomayor is a Boss episode, I think, like, 4.5 years ago. And it was just on the basis of her dissent in Utah v. Strife. Yeah. And for our listeners, Utah v. Strife is the case where essentially basically it was called the Black Lives Matter manifesto. Like, she was the one who actually spoke about the indignities that black people suffer at the hands of cops, blah blah blah. She cited Ta-Nehisi Coates, she cited Michelle Alexander. I was like, okay, this is fantastic. And she has consistently been the one that's like, hey guys, this is how the fucked up shit that you are doing are going to affect actual people.
And she writes so clearly, like, like, she's quotable. I mean, I part of the motivation is that it's like Sotomayor is who y'all think Ruth Bader Ginsburg was. Like, and that's
she's
no
more.
Shade at Ginsburg.
Ginsburg
had trailblazing to do.
Yes.
Right? But having blazed that trail, it is Sotomayor right now who is filling that space. And so
absolutely.
People. But, like, how do you, I had no ability during the last primary to get a sense of, do y'all understand what Sotomayor is doing, and will you appoint judges like that?
Like her, yeah.
Or will you go for judges who are more like Stephen Breyer or Elena Kagan? I had Elena Kagan. I'm not negative about Elena Kagan, but, like, to find a Kagan and trying to find a Sotomayor are two fundamentally different projects.
Yeah, yeah.
And we absolutely. Just don't have candidates, senators, people for running for these offices who know the difference or care. Mm-hmm. Whereas Republicans, they know exactly
what they're looking for.
Yeah. And their wannabe judges know exactly what they're looking for. There's a reason why DC Circuit Judge Naomi Rao sounds like a goddamn crazy person every time somebody gives her a quill. Right. Yeah. There's a reason she sounds like that, because she knows that she wants to be the next Clarence Thomas. And she knows this is how she proves herself, right? There's a reason Brett Kavanaugh sounded the way Brett Kavanaugh did. There's a reason Neil Gorsuch was created in a test tube, right? With the DNA of, like, Antonin Scalia, Robert Burke, and a Native American. Like, that's how they.
That's the only issue he's halfway decent on. That's the only one, and it's so weird. I think it's so. Do you know why that is? Because I don't read his cases very carefully, so I don't know what his history with Native Americans. But I don't know why he's. It's very strange, but it annoys me because it gives him a little bit of credibility. And it doesn't annoy me that he's doing better things for Native American people than the other justices are. But it's like, just because he does this one thing, can you look at all this other crazy shit that he's doing? And can we focus on that as well? Yes, go on.
So I think there are two reasons for that. I've thought about this a lot. So I think there are two reasons. One, he's from your state now. You're a
doctor. I know. I drive by his house on my way to the vet. Like, he wow. lives, his house is real close. I could go buy it, although I don't have the money. But
I could go egg it, perhaps.
We should go fund me. Yeah, maybe I should go egg it for Halloween. Yeah.
So he's one of the few justices that comes from west of the Mississippi. Mm-hmm. And so part of it is just like he has, you know, you go out, you he's been around more Native people than the average bear, right? Yeah. Like like my first exposure to Native Americans was Lou Diamond frickin' Phillips, all right? Yeah. Like that's that's my East Coast bias, right? His was not. Right. So there is just, look, representation matters, experience matters. I say this all the time on the left. It certainly matters on the right, too. And so that's part of it. The other part of it, perhaps because of that experience, that lived experience, he thinks they're people.
Oh, imagine that.
And so it's so obvious when he thinks one group of people is a people versus how he doesn't think, you know, for instance, women black people are people or women are full people. Like, he doesn't think these other groups are people. He thinks Native peoples are peoples. It's like that. It's almost like the in his originalist musings, mm-hmm. they are the most original people. And so...
Jesus Christ. I can totally see him thinking that, though.
And so he gives them peoplehood rights, and that explains most of his jurisprudence. Like it's if you start from the premise that Neil Gorsuch thinks Native American people are just as good as white people, everything else makes sense.
Yeah,
everything else makes sense. And so you can really see when he doesn't think that your label, your group of people, is just as good as white male 18th century people, right? Because it comes out through all his decisions. But, you know, honestly, Neil Gorsuch is not the justice that I have the most problems with. Don't get me wrong. In a normal world, I could spend the rest of my life arguing against Neil Gorsuch, right?
Like, but Neil Gorsuch, I feel like, would fit into that Supreme Court where this polarized, right? Like, he would have been in the middle of a Supreme Court, like, I don't know, the Rehnquist years or something. And it would have been Republican, but it wouldn't have been this I feel like. But I don't have as knowledge about Supreme Court history that you do.
Neil Gorsuch is the fucking nihilist. And the only nihilist. Thing that I... Okay. Right? And unlike Walter Sobchak, I will say, well, at least it's a code. Like, his nihilism itself is an ethos, right? That you can kind of work with or expect. It's the other ones. It's the Alitos and the alleged attempt at rapist Kavanaugh's. These are the people who have no code, who are just always, always grifting, always, always searching for the next way to further the Republican agenda in this country. You saw the stats from this Supreme Court term. The justices that were in the majority, 95% of the time, it was a tie this year for the justices who were in the majority the most. Mm-hmm. Roberts and Kavanaugh. Mm. Folks, this is the Kavanaugh court. He is the median justice. He is the fifth vote on this court. And he's more powerful than Roberts because, as you know, Imani, and a lot of your listeners don't, the key number on the Supreme Court isn't always five. It is four. That's how many votes you need to grant cert. And so Kavanaugh becomes the fourth vote on a bunch of cases that Roberts wouldn't even want to see. If it gets in front of his face, he's going to go with his boys. But Roberts would rather not even see in front of the court. Kavanaugh becomes the fourth vote, along with Thomas, Alito, and Gorsuch, to take all of these awful cases, and then he and Roberts form the core of which way the court is going to go. Mm-hmm. Alito, Gorsuch, Barrett. You know, Barrett was not did not rank particularly high. I mean, better than Sotomayor, but you know, was not particularly high in the rankings for being with the majority, which is a little strange for a new justice, right? Mm-hmm. Who's nominated by the majority party. But your problem right now, it really goes back to Kavanaugh, and this is something that I always give Sotomayor and Kagan credit for.
Well, you've always said that Kavanaugh is stupid. Right. Sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt, but like you're constantly being like, Kavanaugh's just not that smart. And so how does he get on the court? And then, as you said, you know, Sotomayor, they're just like, really, bro? Like, what are you even talking about? This idea that, you know, returning it to the states is a neutral proposition. Sotomayor was like, are you fucking serious, my guy?
He wrote that. Was he what? So yes. So let's bring that up, because when I say Kavanaugh is not that smart, what I'm really saying is that he's either actually dumb or he thinks we are. It's you could take it either way, but he writes like he's dumb or he thinks that there are enough dumb people to believe him. And it was so obvious in Dobbs, where he concurs and he says that the reason why they're ripping away a constitutional right, which it can never be said enough, for the first time in history, for the first time in history, a right recognized by the Supreme Court has been taken away by the Supreme Court. That's never happened before. But Kavanaugh argued that by ripping away this right, he was taking the court out of the political fray, out of the abortion debate, returning it to the states so the court wouldn't have to deal with it and the people's representatives could deal with it. And it's either, again, a purposefully dumb statement, grifting on the fact that he thinks his listeners are stupid, or he's such a freaking idiot that he believes that crap.
Well, because
everybody knows that the very next thing that happens are lawsuits about abortion rights in every single state coming up to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court is now going to be in an abortion case every fucking term.
Every term. And what's fascinating about it, what I keep coming back to this, is that if you wanted to be neutral, you should have done nothing. That would have been the neutral action. The neutral action would have been to deny cert for this case. There was no fucking circuit split. There was no confusion about what courts were supposed to do under the undue burden standard set forth in Casey. Everyone was doing fine. The problem was that conservatives kept losing because they kept introducing laws that violated Roe and Casey. Like, you had an absolute right to terminate a non-viable pregnancy. That's what Roe said. Even Roberts's concurrence, which, you know, frankly, I mean, I don't like what the FedSoc 5 did, but at least I respect it, right? Because they just went for it. They went whole hog. They said, Roe is bullshit, Casey's bullshit, it's gone. Fuck women, we don't care, bitches be crazy, right? Like, essentially, that's what Alito said, too, when he was talking about, oh, the reliance interests were too intangible. For our listeners, when you're going to overturn precedent, one thing that you have to look at is how much people relied on the decision that you're trying to overturn. To say that millions and millions of people relied on Roe would be an understatement, whether it was choosing a career, whether it was turning down a marriage proposal, whether it was, I'm going to shag this guy in the bathroom of this club. Like, people made decisions based on the fact that abortion would be available. And so for Alito to say, oh, those are just musings of the national psyche, which is what I think he said. He said it was too intangible. You're basically saying, bitches, you crazy. And that's just... That's just beyond, that's beyond me. And I'm sure I had a point that I was, am forgetting to get back to.
You were saying that as much as you hate them, Roberts is bullshit.
Right. Thank you. Roberts is bullshit. He comes in with, you guys, can't we all just be reasonable? Can't we just uphold the Mississippi 15-week ban without overturning Roe? No! You literally cannot do that. I wrote a piece that was like, that would have been a coward's compromise, and they would have been gaslighting the public into thinking, we didn't overturn Roe, we just upheld this ban. Those are incongruous, you can't do it. So the fact that Roberts actually wrote that concurrence is ridiculous to me. Like, he wanted a better case. He was happy to overturn Roe and Casey. He just wanted to do it in a way that looked a little bit more legitimate than Mississippi files a petition for cert, says, hey, can you examine this law under Roe and Casey? Then Ginsburg dies. Then Barrett is appointed, nominated, confirmed, and appointed all within the span of like 6 minutes. And then Mississippi's merits brief is due. That's the brief you're supposed to build on your petition for cert. Explain why you want the court to do what you asked them to do in the petition for cert. But in their petition for cert, they said, is this legal under current law? And in their merits brief, they were like, JK, can you just overrule Roe and Casey? You can't even take that case. So the fact that, like, Roberts is talking about, oh, maybe we can compromise, and Kavanaugh's talking about, oh, it's a return to a neutral position, it's mind-boggling. And then you have conservative commentators out there just being like, oh, you can tell those dissenters, they were just so emotional. They were so emotional. It's clear that what the majority did was right, because look at the emotional, you know, emotionally laden response of the dissent. Emotionally laden because they actually took the principles of stare decisis and applied them. And when you talk about the reliance of people on this ruling, you have to talk about what people are going to miss now that they don't have it. And the fact that conservatives seem to think that that was like some kind of bitch ass move is beyond me.
Well, when Barrett was confirmed and Mississippi changed its question, I thought, shit, Roberts has won. Because I thought what would happen after Mississippi changed its question is that Roberts now had the perfect storm to functionally overturn Roe. Very clearly say that he wasn't overturning Roe. And he would have gotten to have his cake and eat it too. And I would have had to spend the entire summer trying to convince people that Roe had been taken away over the objection, by the way, of women's rights groups, right? Because they would have had an interest in saying, no, there's still, you can still do, and stop telling people that there's no rights to abortion, because there still is somewhere, right?
Like, and that goes back to the original point, which is Roe didn't just say you have a right to an abortion. Roe said more than that, but go on.
Exactly. So I thought that was going to be my cross when the opinion linked. I was like, oh damn, they're just going to they're just going to fire festival this. They're just going to be legends.
Yeah.
All right. And that changed the game. But one of the things, and I wrote about this in The Nation, I want your listeners to understand, people need to understand how we got here, how conservatives got from let's look at the reliance interests to straight YOLO, right? Because in 1992, in Planned Parenthood v. Casey, Roe is upheld. It's upheld with new restrictions and new bullshit and whatever, but the fundamental principle of Roe is upheld 5-4. All five justices who voted in the majority in Planned Parenthood v. Casey were appointed by Republican presidents. Mm-hmm. All five.
All seven in Roe were Republicans too.
Right? All seven justices in Roe that decided Roe v. were appointed by Republican presidents. The Planned Parenthood v. Casey court, 8 of the 9 justices were appointed by Republicans, and the one who wasn't dissented. So, like, how do we go in 30 years from Republicans being able to uphold Roe to Republicans being willing to gut it? And it goes back to that word that phrase that you said that is so important, the reliance interests. The Republicans 30 years ago did not like abortions, did not like federal government power, did not like promiscuous sluts, and certainly had a Confederacy love of states' rights. All of that was true 30 years ago. But people like Sandra Day O'Connor and Anthony Kennedy and David Souter, they understood that no court could stop abortions. No society in the history of society has stopped abortions. People will seek control over their own bodies, whether the court or the state or the tyrant says they can or not. It's going to happen. The question is simply, is it going to be regulated? Is it going to be safe? That's the only question the court is able to decide. And so the court in Casey was like, we want it regulated, we want it safe, but we understand we can't stop it. We understand that people have based their lives around the idea that this is here. Fast forward 30 years, and we have a court that does not care.
They don't care at all
about these practical concerns, right? But that thought process, that mental flaw where you don't care about the practicalities of your decision has actually infected the entire court. It's not just Dobbs that it explains. It explains everything else they're doing. Mm-hmm. It explains West Virginia EPA, because if you're so addled that you simply don't care that women are going to have abortions, then you also cannot care about climate change. It explains New York State Rifle Pistol Association versus Bruin, because if you're not going to care about women having abortions, then guess what? You're not going to care about gun violence. Clarence Thomas in Bruin literally says that judges should not look at statistics on gun violence before making decisions on gun cases, which is just the stupidest thing I've ever heard. It's just a straight see no evil, hear no evil approach to life. And that's mm-hmm. Thomas and Bruin, not just in Dobbs, right? It all goes back to Samuel Alito and Citizens United when Obama's telling the court to their face what Citizens United is going to do. And Samuel Alito, not true. It's totally true, Sam. And you know it is. Yeah. You just don't care.
They don't care.
And that's what this court is. The court of not caring about reality.
Ugh, my goodness. Well,
we're screwed.
Sorry. Yeah, we are screwed. And I don't like to leave on a sour note. So what are you, I know you play video games. What are you playing right now besides Stray? Are you playing Stray, this new cat game that came out?
Man, I don't even like cats. I walk around this city as a cat, maybe. I'll probably check it out because, I mean, it's a unique experience,
it's
right?
Like no, but I think you got to try it out just for the memes, right? So you'll understand right? the memes.
So I understand what the kids are doing. That's really right. Like, it's like the same reason why I watched Twilight. Like, I'm too old for it, but I had to know Team Edward, right, and Team Robert Pattinson. Jacob. Okay, team so I can Jacob, be yeah, there yeah. with the kids. Right. My main game right now is Final Fantasy 14. It has been for about a year now. Okay. I love the game. I play it like super incognito. So obviously my character is black, as Don Lemon might say, openly black. But it's not me. Like, I'm not trying to be known or reckon. I'm not trying to talk about politics in the game. I'm just trying to kill some gods, right? Yeah. I'm just trying to whatever. So that's my main game. I my best friend is like huge into Destiny. He's like one of those guys with a guild and a thing.
Mine
and
too.
Right.
Mine too. Like, he's been playing for like 5 years straight, like raids. Like, it's unbelievable to me. Destiny 1 and then Destiny 2. I'm like, can you play some Overwatch with me or something? Anything? But nope. It's all
you got to do this raid and try to get the drop for Galadrihorn and then blah, blah, blah. Like, this just.
Have 100... you played it all?
Oh, yeah. So
I've gone through like the main campaigns, and I'm, you know, now that I can shoot, I'm pretty good at it, but it's just the endless raids and then the crucible part. Like, where you're
I hate the
fucking crucible.
So, the crucible is the PvP mode. Like, I hate
it's terrible.
Because I don't know the maps, and there's something about me. Like, I have an ego, sure, but like, I am able to tolerate failure, but there is something about getting shot in the face by 15-year-olds that I just,
that's
like,
just
I can't.
Very depressing.
Right.
Like, as soon as you come out of the spawn, you get sniped in the head, and you're like,
so
the
there
hell,
was one man? Time, so, sorry, last story. So there was one time, it wasn't Destiny, it was a different PvP game. I think it might have been Overwatch, actually. And so voice chat was open, so I get in trouble because I don't remember the game and how the voice chat works, and if it was TeamSpeak or Discord, I don't remember the mechanic I was using to talk. I just remember I was talking. And so this kid, who was clearly a kid from clearly the South, he wasn't being racist, but he was just being like, man, you slow. You a slow man. Are you old? Are you very old? And I just was so angry. I was just like, yeah, I was a numb. I mean, I just wanted some street cred. And so I invented basically a whole NOM story
based on
like a Ken Burns book or something that I read. And the kid was like, well, you know, thank you for your service.
That is amazing. That's hilarious.
Stolen valor.
Fantastic. Well, Elie, someday I'm going to convince you to hop on Twitch with me and we're going to game and we're going to talk about this stuff. It's going to happen. I know you're reverse
don't
to
starve.
It, but it's going to
happen.
Don't
starve, right? You play Don't Starve, right?
Don't Starve. I will start playing Don't Starve if you play. I will play what you want to play because I really think it would be fun to get on stream. Right. We could do it as a fundraiser to fundraise for abortion funds or something.
I like that idea.
Elie, you're amazing. I'm so glad that we're friends now. I don't even know how I met you. I think I just started stalking you on Above the Law like back in 2012 because I thought you were hilarious. And then you like moved up and I was like, yeah, you moved up about the same time I moved up in like the journalism world. And now I'm just really glad. I feel like we don't work together, but I feel like we work together. I feel like we're in the.
You are my wife's favorite person on Twitter.
Aw. Well, if things don't work out with her, send her my way. I'll raise your kids. It'll be great. But Elie, thank you so much. Listeners, you have had the pleasure of listening to Elie Mystal of The Nation, who is also on MSNBC all the time. One of the few people who is on the regular blowing shit up, often on The Readout, and Tiffany Cross, who I feel like The Readout and Tiffany Cross need to call me, but that's okay. I'm not mad. I ain't mad. But I would like to say for you listeners, thank you so much for sticking with us. We are entering a new chapter of Boom Lawyered. We're very excited about it. We know that you're going to stick around. You're part of our family. If you want to donate to us, we will always take your money. Donate to rewirenewsroom.com/donate. It's going to keep this abortion ship afloat. We got a lot of work to do. Elie, thank you very much. And to our listeners, oh, wait, you can follow Elie on Twitter at Elie Mystal. And you can follow me on Twitter at Angry Black Lady. You know how to spell that. It's easy. And since Jess isn't here to say I'll see you on the tubes, I will say it. I'll see you on the tubes, folks.